A very good evening, everyone. This is Dr. Singaram. In today's session, I'll be discussing the pediatrics question which came in the recently conducted FMG August 2020 exam. Before I start the discussion, please note that this is only for academic purposes and cannot be directly related to the patient care. Let's see the first question. A 2-month-old baby is having watery discharge or fluid leakage from the umbilicus. What is the reason? Failure of midgut to canalize, failure of involution of allantoid duct, failure of involution of omphalomycetic duct and failure of rotation of midgut. The clue here in the question is there is an unusual watery discharge or a fluid leakage from the umbilicus. Normally it does not happen, isn't it? So what is that connection from the umbilicus to some internal organ which causes watery discharge? Okay, it is something like a urine. It is actually the urine which is leaking out from the umbilicus. That means examiner wants you to know what is the connection between the urinary tract and the umbilicus. It is nothing but allantois. Okay, right. So let us see that little bit in detail. In this particular picture, this structure is the bladder and this is the umbilicus. Okay, and this is the abdominal wall. What is the normal connection between the umbilicus and the bladder embryologically? It is something what we call it as the allantois or the allantoic duct. Okay, right. And this is what we call it as a uracus. This is what we call it as a uracus. The connection between the bladder and the umbilicus is what we call it as a uracus. Normally what happens to the uracus? Normally the lumen of the uracus after birth will obliterate. And what does it form? This by itself is an MCQ question. Or in other words, they can ask you what is the remnant of uracus after birth. Okay, it forms something called as a median umbilical ligament. This is what is happening normally. Right. Now what happens, the abnormality which we are going to discuss is what is depicted in the picture, wherein unusually the communication between the bladder and umbilicus is still present, so that the fluid from the bladder, which is nothing but the urine, comes out through the umbilical opening. This is what we call it as the abnormality and the question, which is the patent uracus. So what is this patent uracus? Patent uracus is nothing but failure of involution or failure of disappearance or regression of the allantois. So the allantois is just not getting obliterated. That is what is called as a patent uracus. So for this particular question, the answer obviously is going to be failure of involution of allantoic duct. What is the name of that? It is called as a patent uracus. The key word here is watery discharge coming out from the umbilicus. Right. Let's see the next question. The next question is a pediatric patient presented with headache, ear discharge, fever, reservoir sign is present. What is the diagnosis? Whenever there is a fever and ear infection, you know it is something which is related to the ear infection. And the clue in this particular question is reservoir sign. With this one word itself, you can tell the diagnosis. What is the diagnosis? The answer is acute mastoiditis. When we talk about infection of the mastoid or mastoiditis, you should all remember that the initial infection would be something in the ear, which is acute suppurative otitis media. Only the extension of this infection is going to be presenting as acute mastoiditis. So what you need to remember is that whenever a patient is presenting with acute suppurative otitis media and if he is having persistent fever or persistent pain, what type of pain? Posterior auricular pain, for a period of more than 3 weeks, and especially if he is not responding to antibiotics, then you have to keep in your mind the diagnosis of acute mastoiditis. Okay, the key feature of this acute mastoiditis is discharge. Okay, because it's an infection, it is going to be a purulent discharge, what we also call it as a mucopurulent discharge. And sometimes it is also pulsatile, what we call it as a lighthouse sign. Right, this is a feature of acute mastoiditis. So what is this reservoir sign, which was the key to diagnose this particular question? Reservoir sign is nothing but once you wipe off the discharge, okay, it will again reaccumulate. So this is what is called as a reservoir sign. What is this? Rapid reaccumulation of the discharge is what we call it as the reservoir sign, a very, very special sign which you should always remember for acute mastoiditis. Other than this fever, discharge and pain, the patient can also have the next complaint, which is swelling in the mastoid region, which is behind the ear. Mastoid swelling. Okay, right. Post-auricular swelling. Next thing is, there may be sagging or edema of the posterosuperior wall of the external ear canal. Okay, in the external ear canal, there is sagging or edema of the posterosuperior wall. This is a very important point. Posterosuperior wall of the bony external ear canal. Okay, right, posterosuperior wall. What is the reason for this? The reason is because of inflammation of the bone, which is what we call as a periosteitis. Okay, periosteitis. Right, so these are some of the important points which you need to remember regarding this question. For this particular question, the answer is reservoir sign pointing to the diagnosis of acute. This is the question and the corresponding answer. Let's move to the next question, a very classical question. In a pediatric patient with seizure, which drug is initially used in the management? Any patient who is presenting with seizure in front of you, be it a pediatric patient or adult patient, the initial choice is always going to be benzodiazepine. Okay, it is intravenous benzodiazepine. Okay, the example of intravenous benzodiazepine given in this question is diazepam, and hence the answer is option A, which is diazepam. Remember, not only diazepam, any benzodiazepine will be the first choice drug. Okay, right. What is the general route? The route is generally intravenous. That's what you need to remember. If intravenous route could not be secured, intramuscular route can also be done, especially for cases of midazolam. Okay, right. What is the other alternative? You can also give perrectal diazepam. Perrectal diazepam is other alternative. Only diazepam can be given by this perrectal route. And other option, especially when you are in the hospital settings, intranasal midazolam also can be used. Please remember, these alternative routes should be used only when intravenous route could not be obtained. IV cannot be obtained. Okay, right. So initial drug is always diazepam. Suppose the same question, instead of a pediatric patient, okay, they use the word, which is the drug of choice for controlling seizure in a neonate, then your answer would automatically change to phenobarbital. Okay, right, phenobarbital. The next question which can come, okay, in an adult or a pediatric patient, benzodiazepine is given, but still the seizure is not controlled. What should be the second choice drug? Not second choice, the next drug. The next drug is going to be the second option, which is phenytoin. Okay, you can also use the better version, which is fosphenytoin. Right, so that's about this particular question. For this question, option A is the answer. This is a very standard question. A child presented with 18 episodes of loose stools and 4 episodes of vomiting. He is irritable but drinks water. What is the treatment? Remember, in any child who is having this loose stools or diarrhea, our cornerstone of management is fluid management. This question exactly asks that, what is the fluid? Whether it's IV fluid followed by ORS, or ORS only, or plain water. First of all, remember, we have to assess the level of dehydration. In this particular child, you can very clearly notice the child is irritable, but the next word is drinking water. That means this is a case of not severe dehydration and all, it is some dehydration. The child is having some dehydration. Remember, the child is drinking water, child is also having some dehydration only. So definitely it is going to be oral and not IV fluid. So first two options are not going to be the answer. Whether it's a plain water or ORS, you all know that the cornerstone of management of diarrhea is ORS, and hence the answer for this question is ORS only. Let us look a little bit about this question. In some dehydration, what are the features? The child is generally alert. The child is irritable. Child may be normal, but the child is irritable. Irritable child. One more very important, which is not given in the question, but still a clue was given, is that child is very, very thirsty and the child eagerly drinks water. These are the characteristic features of some dehydration. Why this is important? Because in severe dehydration, child will be drowsy, child will be lethargic, not able to drink the water. And the treatment plan is what we call it as plan B. Remember, plan A is for no dehydration, plan B is for some dehydration, plan C is for severe dehydration. What does it tell you? It is nothing but ORS only. ORS will be the treatment of choice, because you know that child is thirsty and drinking water eagerly. Only thing is that you have to know some values, which is a correction of dehydration. What is that correction of dehydration? 75 ml per kg in the first 4 hours has to be given as ORS only. followed by that you have to give maintenance, which is nothing but replacement of ongoing loss. What is ongoing loss? I am talking about the loose tools. Okay, replacement of the water lost in the loose tools, which is roughly like 10 to 20 ml per kg per loose tool, or you can also remember like 100 to 200 ml for every loose tool. Okay, this is for every loose tool. Okay, right. Plus, don't forget, child should daily fluid requirements should also be met, which is nothing but holiday cigar formula. Okay, it is remembered as for the first 10 kg, it is 100 ml per kg. Okay, for the next 10 kg, that means for the first 10, you would have already calculated 1000 ml. For that 1000 ml plus for the next 10 kg, you have to add 50 ml per kg for every subsequent kg. For example, the child is 12 kg. What are you going to do? For the first 10 kg, you are going to give 1000 ml. Plus for the next 2 kg, you are going to give 2 into 50, which is 100 ml. So the answer would be 1000, 100 ml, like that. Now after 20 kg, that means for the first 20 kg, you would have given 1500 ml. You would have calculated 1500 ml. To that, every kg after 20 kg, you are going to add 20 ml per kg. For example, a child is weighing 22 kg. What would be the amount of fluid required for daily maintenance? It is 1500 ml plus 2 into 20, which is 40 ml. So 1540 ml would be the answer for this particular thing. Okay, right. So going back to the question was about some dehydration, and the answer is going to be ORS only. Next question is relatively new question in the FMG exam, but it is based on a very simple concept of what is the maturation of a preterm baby. A mother delivered 33 weeks preterm. 33 weeks old means it's a 33 weeks preterm baby via normal vaginal delivery with no complications at birth. That means baby cried after birth. There was no problem for the baby, but it was a preterm baby. Okay, right. What is the preferred method of feeding the neonate? Whether it is OGT. OGT means orogastric tube feeds. Direct breastfeeds, palliative feeds, or parental nutrition. I'll tell you the answer, then I'll go to the explanation. The answer for this is palliative feeds. Other option also can be given, which is Katori spoon feeds. Whatever was given in the exam, that would be the answer. It is palliative feeds or Katori spoon feeds. What led me to the answer was the gestational age of the baby, which in this case was 33 weeks. Now I'm going to tell you a very important table which you all need to remember. It is based on the gestation age, you decide the initial feeding method. You can see that if the child is less than 28 weeks, there is lack of propulsive motility of the gut. The meaning of this is that even if you give breast milk to the baby, because of improper motility, okay, the milk may not pass down the gastrointestinal tract, or in other words, it's not going to be efficiently absorbed. So no way you are going to give breast milk for a baby who's born at less than 28 weeks of gestation. What are you going to do? Yes, you are not going to do any type of enteral or the gastrointestinal feeding. You are going to go for parenteral nutrition, which is what we call it as a TPN. TPN means what? Total parenteral nutrition. This is for a baby born less than 28 weeks. Between 28 to 31 weeks of gestation. Remember, at this time, the baby may have some sucking movement, but it is not at all adequate. Okay, there is a very poor coordination between the suck, swallow, and breathing. So what is the problem? If you try to breastfeed the baby will aspirate. Very simple. So that is why at this time, between 28 to 31 weeks of gestation, you are going to go for orogastric tube feeds or nasogastric tube feeds. Right. Now, between 32 to 34 weeks of gestation, the sucking has got better, but it is not fully mature. So again, there is a minimal risk of aspiration, right? So we are not going to give again direct breastfeeding. Here, it is going to be palliative feeds or spoon feeds. What is that spoon? Katori spoon feeds. Between 32 to 34 weeks, right? After 34 weeks, it's a mature sucking pattern with a very good coordination. So you can go for direct breastfeeds. Direct breastfeeding. It is after 34 weeks of gestation. Right. Our question was regarding 33 weeks, which is in between 32 to 34 weeks. And hence the answer is palliative feeds or Katori spoon feeds. Let's look at the next question. A 6-year-old child presented with abdominal pain, hematemesis and palpable spleen. The child had a history of exchange transfusion for neonatal jaundice. What is a probable diagnosis? What is the presentation of this child first of all? The child is having a splenomegaly or palpable spleen. Along with that, the child is also having hematemesis, which is upper gastrointestinal bleeding. What is a combination of splenomegaly and upper GI bleed tell you? It is nothing but portal hypertension. By definition, what is portal hypertension? Portal hypertension is defined as the portal venous pressure of more than 10 to 12 millimeters of mercury. This is by definition. And what is the commonest reason for the pressure to increase in the portal venous system? It is nothing but obstruction. It is usually due to obstruction in the portal venous system, the pressure is increasing. Now, depending on where is the obstruction, we classify the types of portal hypertension into prehepatic, posthepatic, and hepatic, right? Okay, hepatic means inside the liver. Prehepatic means before the liver, that is somewhere in the portal venous system or the splenic venous system. And posthepatic is after the liver is crossed, okay? Like for example, the IVC, okay, the hepatic veins like that, okay? Right. Now, you should know overall the most common cause or what you get in adults is hepatic cause, which is cirrhosis, right? However, in children, as this question is asking, if they ask you which is the most common cause, please remember it is not in the liver, it is outside the liver. What we call it as EHPVO. What is EHPVO? It is nothing but expansion of extrahepatic portal venous obstruction. Extrahepatic portal venous obstruction. And what do you think fits into the answer for this particular question? You must have guessed by this time, the answer is option D, which is portal vein thrombosis. Very simple. Okay. Only one point to be remembered. The most common cause of portal hypertension is outside the liver, which is extrahepatic portal venous obstruction, portal venous thrombosis. Now, they have given you a clue to this portal vein thrombosis also. What is that? The clue is right here. What is this? Exchange transfusion for neonatal jaundice. What is this exchange transfusion? We are taking out the blood of the baby and exchanging a fresh blood. How do you do that? You catheterize the umbilical vein, right? You catheterize the umbilical vein. So, umbilical catheterization is what is done before we attempt this exchange transfusion. Umbilical catheterization. Now, this umbilical catheterization is by itself a risk factor for development of portal venous thrombosis. And that was a clue given in this particular question. So, the answer for this particular question is option D, portal vein thrombosis, and the condition given in the clinical case was portal hypertension. The next question is a repeat of a recently asked FMJ question itself. It's a one-year-old child presenting with first episode of wheeze and breathing difficulty. Chest x-ray shows bilateral hyperinflation. What is the probable causative organism? It's a straightforward question. First episode, it's always remembered like this. First episode wheeze in a child less than 2 years is clinically nothing but an infection of the lower respiratory tract. What is it? It is acute bronchiolitis, which is what exactly is the case. Even though x-ray is not required for the diagnosis, if you take the x-ray, you will find the classical bilaterally hyperinflated lung fields. Okay, very classical. It's a clinical diagnosis. First episode wheeze in a child less than 2 years. And what is the etiological agent for acute bronchiolitis is the question. The answer is straightforward. The answer is going to be RSV infection. What is RSV? It is respiratory syncytial virus, which is the most common cause of acute bronchiolitis. As I said in my previous videos, every year we expect a question on breast milk or the human milk. But this time it was slightly different, where they compared the human milk not with the cow milk but with the buffalo milk. Okay. True regarding buffalo milk when compared with the human milk is the question. I will straight away go to the answer and then provide you the relevant data. The answer is buffalo milk contains high calories and high proteins when compared to the breast milk or the human milk. This is the picture for you all to see, which is a comparison of human milk, cow milk and buffalo milk. You can see that the energy content is higher in the buffalo milk. It is 117 per 100 ml, whereas it's only 65 to 67 kilocalories in the human milk and the cow milk. And you can also see that the protein is very high. Can you see that? 4.3 in comparison to 1.1. Not only that, fat is also very high in the buffalo milk. Okay, it is very thick. Okay, fat is also very high in the buffalo milk compared to any other type of milk. Okay, so what I would want you to remember is the highest energy, fat as well as the protein content is present in buffalo milk. Okay, in buffalo milk. What about water content? Okay, one more one liner. Water content is, you can see very clearly, what is that? It is highest in the breast milk. Okay, it's highest in the breast milk. That's why we always say that when a baby is breastfeeding, the baby does not require any additional water, because you can see 88% of breast milk is nothing but water. Okay, right. Highest carbohydrate content. Again, look at the table. Where is the carbohydrate content high? You can see that 7.4 is for the human milk, right? What is the predominant carbohydrate? Yes, it is nothing but lactose. So highest carbohydrate content, the answer is going to be again breast milk. What was one more question? Actually, a potential question for the future. Where is the highest calcium and phosphorus content? Again, you can see here calcium and phosphorus, you can see 210 and 130, which is very high in the last column, which is a buffalo milk. Okay, so again, highest calcium and phosphorus would be in buffalo milk. Okay, right. So these are some of the one-liners which can be potentially asked in the coming exam. So please make a note of it. I keep telling this about this particular topic of guidelines for management of pneumonia in the community. I say that every year, every exam, one question will be definitely there, and it came in this exam also. So what is the question? A 3-month-old child present with the complaints of fever, cough, not able to feed and breathing difficulty. On examination, respiratory rate was 58 per minute. Chest retractions were present. What is the management? Okay, whether it is pneumonia, no pneumonia, severe pneumonia, very severe pneumonia. First, let me make one thing very clear. According to the present classification, which is actually revised WHO guidelines for management of pneumonia in the community, there is no terminology called very severe pneumonia. This has been taken out. So never ever consider this option anytime in future. This very severe pneumonia category is taken out. You have to decide whether it is no pneumonia, pneumonia or severe pneumonia. Okay, right. Let us see. The child is having respiratory rate of 58. Remember, for a 3-month-old child, anything more than 50 per minute will be called as fast breathing. So definitely child is having fast breathing, and along with that, child is also having chest retraction, right? Now, presence of fast breathing and chest retraction will categorize this as pneumonia or a severe pneumonia depending on additional findings. So again, the option of no pneumonia is taken out, because this is definitely pneumonia, right? So no pneumonia is out of question. So now we have to decide whether it is pneumonia or severe pneumonia. For to be categorized as severe pneumonia, you should look for something called as a danger signs. Okay, there are so many danger signs, and one of the danger signs is given in the question itself. What is that? Child is not able to feed, and this is a danger sign. The other danger signs being child having convulsions, child having cyanosis, and a child in general lethargic. These are the danger signs. Whenever danger sign is present, then immediately it categorizes as severe pneumonia. Hence, in this particular question, the answer is severe pneumonia. Give antibiotics and immediately refer the child to hospital. So what antibiotic they can give from the community setup? They can give the first dose of ampicillin along with gentamicin and immediately refer the child to a higher center or the hospital. Okay, right. So this question is about community management of pneumonia. Every time we are expecting question for the upcoming exam also, this question is expected. Identify the probable condition from the given skull X-ray. Okay, what you can see here is there are some lines like this, so many lines like this, and you can see that area of the skull appears to be expanded. Okay, this is what we call it as a hair on end appearance. What is the answer for this question? It's a straightforward one-liner. It is seen in case of chronic hemolytic anemias, especially thalassemias and sickle cell anemias. It is seen, right? So what is the reason for this appearance? I'm sure you must have read about. This is due to prominence of the vertical trabeculae of the bone. What is the reason for this prominence? It is due to this hyperplasia. Remember, there is a hemolysis going on inside the body. So what happens in an attempt to produce more blood cells? Okay, the bone marrow undergoes hyperplasia. The reason for this is bone marrow hyperplasia causing expansion of the skull. Okay, that is the reason for this appearance. And the answer for this question is hemolytic anemias. Okay, right. Let's move on to the next question, a very standard question. All of the following are components of tetralogy of Fallot, or TOF, that's what we call this TOF, that is tetralogy of Fallot. As the name itself suggests, there are four component tetralogy of Fallot. What are the four components? You have overriding of iota, you have subpulmonic stenosis, what we also call it as a infundibular stenosis, There is also the third component is VSD. These are the three components. What is the fourth component? The fourth component is right ventricular hypertrophy. Okay, and please remember, tetralogy of Fallot is the most common cyanotic congenital heart disease encountered in children. So the answer for this question obviously is the last option, which is tricuspid stenosis. It is not a part of tetralogy of Fallot. Again, one more very important topic on Apgar scoring. Very, very important. Apgar score, as the name suggests, from the five letters, you have five variables in the Apgar score. Okay, and each variable is given a score of 0, 1 and 2. Okay, that is what is exactly given in the question. They have asked to find out the total scoring. Okay, so before I discuss the question, let us discuss the Apgar scoring, then I come back to the question. The point I would want you to want to emphasize is that 0 means something which is completely considered as abnormal. Like for example, you can see heart rate of 0 is, or 0 heart rate, absent heart rate is 0. No respiratory effort, 0. Child has doesn't have any tone, so the child is fully limping, it is again 0. Reflex means you put a catheter into the nose of the baby, no response, again 0. Completely bluish in color or completely pale in color is what we call it as, again 0. Okay, right. 0 means something which is completely abnormal. 2 means something which is completely normal. For example, heart rate of more than 100, child is crying, having good respiration, child is moving all four limbs actively, and when you pass the catheter into the nose, child coughs, sneezes or even cries. Okay, that is very normal. And color is completely pink. All parts of the body is pink. Okay, this is 2 or completely normal. 1 is something which is intermediate or in between normal and abnormal. Okay, or you can say, remember, like partially normal. For example, heart rate is less than 100 but it is not 0 is 1. Irregular respiratory effort is 1. There is some flexion of the limbs noted, not actively moving all limbs, then it is again 1. Okay, child shows some facial expression but does not cough, sneeze or cry, then it is called as grimace. Grimace corresponds to a score of 1. This is very, very important for you to remember. Then color. Body is pink. The center part of the body is pink, but the limbs and the legs are bluish in color or cyanose. Then it is called as 1. And body pink, extremities blue is what we call it as acrocyanosis. That is given a score of 1. Okay, so now let's go back to the question. The question is giving the components of Apgar score. You just have to total it up. Grimace on inserting catheter. What does grimace correspond to? I told you 1. Some flexion of the limbs were noted. It is not complete flexion. So that means again score of 1. Heart rate of 120 per minute, which is well more than 100. So it is 2. Okay. Blue extremities were noted. That means what? Score of 1. Okay. Irregular breathing. That means what? Breathing is not regular or normal. Okay. It is not absent also. So it is not 0, but it is 1. So how much is the total? You can very clearly notice that 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 2 plus 1. How much it is? It is nothing but 6. So the total score is 6 and the answer for this question is option B. The next question is based on definition. What is that? A patient's mother, while bathing her child, noticed no testis in the scrotum. Okay. And on examination, one testis, that's on the right side, was in the inguinal region and the left side was in the perineum. What would be your diagnosis at this time? The question is asking about what are you going to say as the diagnosis in this particular child? Whether both are undescended testes, both are ectopic testes, or one is undescended and the one is ectopic. Okay. For this, you have to know what is exactly ectopic and what is exactly undescended testes. You all know that a testes is going to descend from the abdomen, okay, into the scrotum via the inguinal region. This is what we call it as a path of the descent of the testes. This occurs during the gestational age, okay, inside the uterus, okay, right. Now what happens when the descent is arrested, okay, when the descent of the testis is arrested in a normal path, okay, for example, the testis is remaining in the inguinal region, okay, it does not completely come into the scrotum, then it is called as undescended descent. So descent arrested in the normal path of descent is what we call it as undescended testis. Then what is ectopic testis? Ectopic testis means the testis is deviating from the actual path. Okay, the key word here is testis deviates from the actual path. Deviates from the actual path of descent, right? From the actual path of descent. Now, this definition, based on this definition itself, you can say the answer for the question which you can see that on right side they are saying it is in the inguinal region. That means what? It is coming along the normal path, but it is arresting in between. So this is what right side is undescended testis, right? Right side is undescended testis. Now where is the testis on the left side? The left testis was in the perineum. That means what? It is not along the normal path. It has gone somewhere else. So what is this? Left side is ectopic testis. So the answer for this particular question is option C, which is right undescended and left ectopic testis. Very simple. Let's look at the probability of future questions in this particular topic. Okay, I have just given a table for you to remember. In undescended testis, generally the testis is underdeveloped. That's what you need to remember. However, in an ectopic testis, the testis is in a different location, but it is normally developed. Okay. Scrotum again underdeveloped or very poorly developed or not at all developed in extreme cases, in case of undescended testis, whereas in an ectopic testis the scrotum is fully and normally developed. Undescended testis spermatogenesis is abnormal or very poor. It may not be immediately evident after birth, but definitely occurs when the undescended testis is not corrected after a few years. Okay, but in an ectopic testis, it is absolutely normal. Spermatogenesis is absolutely normal. Undescended testis, many cases are associated with indirect inguinal hernia, whereas ectopic testis is never associated with a indirect inguinal hernia. These are the future questions in this particular topic. The next question is again one of the repeat questions. A 4-year-old child presented with fever, running nose and following lesions. What is the probable etiology? What you can see is around the mouth there are some lesions in this particular child, and also in the soles you can see some lesions in this particular child. Okay, now this is a very classical. You can see the age of the child also. It is less than 5 years, 4 years to be precise in this particular condition. This is what we call it as a hand foot mouth disease. Hand foot mouth disease, very classical question. The question is, what is the etiological agent for this hand foot mouth disease? That means what? This child also will have similar lesions in the hand also, in the palms. Okay, palms, soles, oral cavity affected is what we call it as a hand foot mouth disease. It is very commonly caused by Coxsackie virus. Okay, to be very precise, Coxsackie virus A16. And what is the next common organism which is associated with this condition? It is enterovirus 71. Okay, right. There is no specific treatment for this particular condition, but the point to be remembered is that this is a very contagious disease. It can spread by direct contact from the infected child to the other child. So that is why children who are less than 5 years affected by this disease, they may be going to the kindergarten and all, no, they are requested to be remaining in isolation at home till all the lesions have settled. Okay, there is no specific treatment, but it is not a very dangerous disease also. That also has to be remembered. Again, a very classical question. They are given this picture and asked to identify which of the following deficiency of which of the following is associated with this particular condition. What you can see is around the mouth, you can see this lesions, and similar lesions were also given in the perigenital areas. I have not included the picture, but please remember the lesions were also seen surrounding the genitals, okay, perigenital areas. So it is something surrounding the openings like mouth, genital orifices, all those things. So this is a very classical periorificial lesion. Very classical of what condition? Yes, it is zinc deficiency. This child also will have a recurrent diarrhea, and this condition is what we refer to as acrodermatitis enteropathica. It is a condition of zinc deficiency. It is actually not a nutrition deficiency, but a inherited condition in an autosomal recessive manner characterized by impaired absorption of zinc from the intestine. Okay, this is called as acrodermatitis enteropathica. Very classical question, has come many times in your exams, should remember the name. Next question, identify the probable etiological agent from the skin finding which is given below. This is probably the chest of the child where the lesions are seen. Okay, so it is something like a rash. Okay, that's what is our understanding. Now, based on this rash, especially in the trunk, okay, our consideration is never going to be HSV and never going to be human papilloma virus. They are not in the consideration. It has to be either chickenpox or measles. Okay, that's what most of the students get confused. I will tell you the answer, then I will put the comparison. The answer is chicken pox. What is the reason is because in this particular picture, there are not only rashes, but what you can see in all these areas is vesicles. Okay, it is not only rashes, but also vesicles. And these vesicles are very characteristic of chicken pox. Okay, what we call it as a, okay, vesicles is something like a swelling which is having a clear fluid. And this clear fluid will be surrounded, vesicle will be surrounded by redness, area of redness. That is what we call it as a dew drops. That's what is a vesicle surrounded by redness. That's a rose petal appearance. So dew drops surrounded by a rose petals. Okay, dew drops in a rose petal appearance is what we classically say as chickenpox lesions. Second point to be remembered is that some of the lesions are bigger in size, some of the lesions are smaller in size. This is because in chickenpox, not on one particular day all the lesions will erupt. Today some lesions will appear, tomorrow some lesions will appear, day after tomorrow some other lesions will appear. So that means if you see the child on the third or the fourth day, the lesion which has appeared on the first day will appear bigger. The lesion which has appeared just today will be smaller. So different sizes, okay, different sizes of the eruption. Okay, the eruption will have varying sizes. Different size eruptions is also very characteristic of chickenpox. What we call it as a polymorphic. Okay, different sizes. So as I was telling you, in chickenpox, you not only have the rash, you not only have the papule, you also have blisters or the vesicles, which is very, very characteristic. In contrast, in measles, what you get is, you see on the other side of the picture, what you get is maculopapular rash. The most important point is there is no vesicles noted in measles. Okay. Number two is, where does a chickenpox lesion start from? Chickenpox lesion starts in the trunk and spreads to the extremities and the face. Whereas when you look at the measles rash starts in the face or behind the ear and then spreads to the rest of the body. Okay, right. So these are some of the ways by which you can differentiate between chickenpox and measles. One very, very important clue is presence or absence of vesicles. Let's move on to the next question. Next question is, which curvature develops after the baby starts to walk? Okay, first I will tell you the answer, then I am going to tell you the explanation. The answer for this question is secondary lumbar curvatures. Okay, when we talk about the spinal column, okay, there are definitely curvatures in the spinal column. Okay, the spinal curvatures are classified into primary curvatures and secondary curvatures. Please remember, primary curvature is something which is present in the spinal vertebral column before birth itself. That means in the intrauterine life itself, they are present. This is probably to accommodate the folding of the fetus, okay, inside the mother's womb, okay. And what are the areas of the spine which are having primary curvature? One is thoracic, second is sacral, right? Second is sacral. Now, whatever curvatures develop after birth is what we call it as the secondary curvatures, right? They are called as secondary curvatures. Now, obviously, what are the other two areas which are left? Cervical and lumbar, right? Now, when are they going to develop? When the baby starts lifting the head, what curvature develops is the cervical curvature. Okay, right. You can see, you know, lifting the head, okay, neck, head and neck is involved. So cervical curvature develops. When the baby starts walking, okay, when the baby starts bearing the weight, then what curvature will develop? Obviously, the lumbar curvature is going to be developed. This question is asking about when the baby starts to walk, what curvature develops? It is secondary lumbar curvature, and the answer is option D. Let's move on to the next question. I think I have discussed this particular question in the very recently posted video about breastfeeding and breast milk. Those who want to have a bigger picture of the same can have the look at the a related video. Okay, right. So let us discuss this particular question. Mother complains that her baby is not drinking properly from the breast. And now complaints of pain and swelling of the breast. What could be the probable condition? Okay, obviously, when the baby is not drinking properly from the breast, okay, mother will have accumulation of milk inside the breast, which is going to cause swelling. And because of the swelling and congestion, there is also associated pain. This is a straightforward question. This condition is what we call it as a breast engorgement. I agree that pain and swelling also will be present in breast abscess and mastitis also. But in both these conditions, there would be associated fever. And in case of breast abscess, the mother may be even sick also. She will have raised WBC count, raised ESR, all those things would have been given. But nothing is given, no fever at all. So, breast abscess and mastitis are out of this particular question. In sore nipple also is out of this question, because in sore nipple, there won't be any complaints of swelling of the breast. There may be some pain in the breast region, but there is no swelling of the breast. So, breast abscess, mastitis and sore nipple are differential, but they are all ruled out. Okay, answer for this question is breast engorgement. I'll tell you the condition where they are, where it is going to occur. Let's imagine like this. Mother is feeding the baby, but she is not properly positioning the baby. Improper positioning leading on to improper attachment of the baby to the mother's breast. So what happened? The baby cannot feed properly from the mother. So this results in accumulation of milk inside the breast. That is what we call it as a breast engorgement. Please remember, for this particular condition, the treatment is mother has to properly position the baby and continue feeding. That is the most important part in the management. Second, to overcome this swelling of the breast, she can be advised local warm water packs. Breast massage also can be advised. And for the pain, you can advise some analgesics, all that is needed. But most important, she should not stop breastfeeding. She should continue to give breastfeeding. And very important, even more important, is correct positioning of breastfeeding should be followed. So that was about the discussion of questions from pediatric section in the recently conducted FMG exam. Next video, I'm planning to do the medicine and related subject. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe to the channel to get notified of the videos as and when they are posted. Don't forget to press the bell icon. And if you have any questions or you want any modification in the questions or the option, please put it up in the comment section below. I will reply. Thanks for watching, and I will see you very soon in another video. Have a good day.